fact that you're not saying anything means you're okay with it. What this says is that the partial derivative with respect to x of this term, kx dh and dx, plus the partial derivative with respect to y, plus z, plus this other term r, is equal to this derivative here. And what this says, this is all of the flows in and flows out of a groundwater system, plus whatever is added through rainfall, evaporation, injection or extraction, must equal change in storage. So if we have a groundwater system, we have water coming in, we have water going out. If one of these is greater than the other, water level must change, must go up or down. And that's exactly what this equation says. And the most important thing on this equation is that. The most important thing in any equation is that. Left-hand side must equal right-hand side. Whatever comes in, less what goes out, must affect the change in water level. As I said, it's based on two laws. It's based on Darcy's law, and it's based on mass conservation. I'm going to go through those with you to explain the physical processes that are incorporated within this equation. This is the basis of all groundwater modeling. So understanding it, understanding what goes into it, is an important part of being able to model groundwater flow. So Darcy's law. Darcy was an architect in France in the 1830s. He was trying to build a building on saturated sand. And he noticed when he first started building that as he put weight on the sand, there was a certain amount of subsidence of that weight. He tried to understand what was causing that. You put pressure on a certain sediment and it has some effect on the saturation of that sediment. So in terms of stability, he needs to understand what was causing that. So he developed this apparatus that looked at water coming in one end and going out at the other. And what he did, using different types of sediments in here or sands, he estimated what the flow rate would be experimentally. And he came up with this set of relations. That if we have a hydraulic head at one end of our sand column and a lower hydraulic head at the other end, it doesn't matter what direction this is aligned. This can be vertical, vertically up, vertically down, horizontal. The relationship is still exactly the same. It's a function initially of the difference in head between the one end and the other. And the flow rate, he determined, was directly proportional to that difference in head. He found the flow rate was inversely proportional to the length of this column. So a longer column would have a lower flow rate, shorter column, a higher flow rate. He determined that the flow rate was also a function of the cross-sectional area. So as this column was larger or smaller, that would again affect the rate linearly. So he found that the flow rate that came out here was a function of all of these variables. So mathematically, then what he could do is put or determine flow rate was proportional to, so just ignore this for a minute, flow rate was proportional to the cross-sectional area, the difference in head, and the difference in length. So if the flow rate is proportional to each of these, it must be equal to them multiplied by some sort of constant or fudge factor. The reason it's negative is that water will flow with a negative gradient. So it'll flow from high to low. So as this derivative is negative, the flow rate is positive. That's where the negative comes from. But what this is saying is that the volumetric flow rate through a groundwater system is proportional to cross-sectional area, the hydraulic gradient, and the coefficient of proportionality, this K, was a function of the soils. So as he changed the soils in his column, so this flow rate changed. So this fudge factor was given the name of hydraulic conductivity. It is specific for each soil, and it allows us to estimate how much water is going to flow through a soil based on cross-sectional area and difference in height. Each of these has specific units. And one thing that I want to mention very, 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 and let me say one more time, very importantly, always use units and make sure they're always consistent. So the units on the left-hand side must balance the units on the right-hand side. In hydrogeology, units of meters per day, meters per second, kilometers per hour, all get used. My strong suggestion is choose one set of units. Preferably, I like meters per day, and stick with it. So if you're given data in centimeters, convert it to meters. If you're given it in seconds, convert it to days. That way you're always dealing with the same set of units. This is the groundwater flow equation. So conservation of mass simply says that flows in minus flows out must equal change in storage. Water flows in, water flows out, water level goes up or down. Sorry, hydraulic head goes up or down. If we're in a confined aquifer is always confined. Water level does not change. Hydraulic head does. Why do we care about a water balance? Because it flows in greater than flows out, so if more water is going into our system than it's flowing out, what we end up with is rising groundwater levels. In the other case, it flows in, if less is flowing in than flows out, we get falling groundwater levels. And each of these has specific physical connotations. Falling groundwater levels means there's not enough water for irrigation and potable use. Rising groundwater levels may mean that you end up contaminating soils, because if the water is contaminated, it then can enter the soil column and get into agriculture. So it's important to know what's going on in the system. This is modeling. It's your understanding of the system. So very quickly, because I'm a mathematician, I need to put some mathematics into it. So I want you just to follow through fairly quickly. What I'm doing here is I'm taking a little segment of a groundwater system, and I'm trying to develop a mass balance for that. And what I've said is we look at flows coming in, flows going out, and try and balance them. So if we start off on in the x direction, the mass flowing in to the face in the x direction is density by flow rate times cross-sectional area. This little unit has the length of that side is dz, the length of that side is dy, the length of this side is dx. So the cross-sectional area in the x direction is dy to z, density of the water is rho, qx is the flow rate. This is the flow rate coming into this side. This is what comes out. What comes out is equal to the amount that went in plus whatever change occurred to this amount over that distance. So this is what comes in, this is what goes out. Exactly the same amount plus whatever change occurred. So we're only looking at the change across there as being the difference. We do the same in the y direction and the same in the z direction. So water in, water out. The change in that is what must balance. That's mass conservation. So if we take each of these terms, subtract the outflow from the inflow, what we find is that these two just go away, and that is the change. That's the change in the x direction, the change in the y direction, the change in the z direction. We can also consider the fact, well, this is a flow rate. We know how to estimate the flow in groundwater hydrology. It's using Darcy's law. So when we replace this with Darcy's law and look at the change, what we end up with is this equation. So I've dropped out a half a dozen steps because you don't care, and I don't either. This looks at the change in the x direction. And as I've said, I've replaced flow with Darcy's law, and that's the form of Darcy's law in the x direction. That's the y direction, that's the z direction. This is the change in flow through our little piece of groundwater. That change in flow must equal the change in storage. This is our groundwater flow equation. But it's just looking at what flows in minus what flows out, change in storage. We have to include another term, and this allows for rainfall, evaporation, pumping, extracting water, or injection. So this includes all of the other physical phenomena that may go into our little groundwater system. This is the groundwater flow equation for aquifer. This is the basis of all groundwater modeling, this equation for a confined aquifer. A confined aquifer is always saturated, and we assume it is anisotropic because we have different kx, ky, z, kz in each of the directions. Now, this is for a confined aquifer. If we look at the situation for an unconfined aquifer and consider our little block of groundwater, an unconfined aquifer, it's not fully saturated. So in an unconfined aquifer, somewhere the water level exists. So this is our full unconfined aquifer. Unconfined aquifer has water level only at a certain location. In this case, when we look at our flows in minus flows out, we've got to consider that the heights of our flow in is no longer that full extent, but it's actually the thickness of the saturated zone, which is H. So the amount that flows in the X direction, density by flow rate, by cross-sectional area, cross-sectional area is delta y, but the height of it is only h. So this is what flows in, this is what flows out, the same amount plus whatever change. In an unconfined aquifer, we don't care what happens in the vertical direction. We only worry about what happens in the horizontal direction. So when we go through the same process as we did for a confined aquifer, what we have is this equation. This says that the flow in, sorry, the change of flow in the X direction plus the change of flow in the Y direction plus any other amount, rainfall, ET, extraction, injection, must equal the change in storage. Now this equation is quite different than the previous one. In this equation, H appears only once in each of these terms and once here. This is referred to as a linear equation or simple. Getting a solution for this equation with these being variable is difficult. But in terms of H, and that's what we're trying to find, hydraulic head, in terms of H, this is a very simple equation. This equation is not simple because there's an H there and an H there. So if we're trying to solve this equation for hydraulic head, we've got a non-linear term for these two, which makes the solution of the groundwater flow equation for an unconfined aquifer specifically more difficult. And we'll see that when we look into solutions of those two systems. If we have the case of a homogeneous isotropic hydraulic conductivity, then the K is a constant. They can be pulled out of these terms and we end up with this expression here. So we have the two different equations for the two different types of aquifers. And as I said an hour ago, we need to be very specific about what type of aquifer we're dealing with. Because the way each aquifer responds is very different. A confined aquifer responds linearly. An unconfined aquifer responds non-linearly. Anytime we have a partial differential equation, and any of you that have done engineering or mathematics at high school or university should know this, anytime we have a differential equation, we can only solve that differential equation if we have appropriate boundary conditions. And that's true in groundwater hydrology. So here we have two differentials, here we have another two, there we have one. So we need conditions in order for us to solve a model or the groundwater flow equation in a real life system. So if we're looking at this as a case of a set of aquifers, we have an artesian aquifer here, or a confined aquifer, unconfined aquifer, confining beds, we must know boundary conditions. We must know how much water is flowing in to our model areas. Either we need to know how much water is flowing in, or we need to know what the hydraulic head is on this boundary. And we need a condition for every derivative. So let me go and summarize where we are, and then make sure you understand where we are. This is the groundwater flow equation for a confined aquifer. It considers fully variable soils. It considers all inputs. We're trying to solve it for hydraulic head, because if we know hydraulic head everywhere in our groundwater basin, then we know what groundwater flow is. Know what the head is, then it will flow from high to low. So this is what we're trying to solve this equation for, hydraulic head. Hydraulic head varies in the X, Y, Z, and T direction. It's a four-dimensional parameter. have to have a solution domain. We've got to have an area or a volume that we want to understand hydraulic head and solve using some understanding or model. So we need to define what that is. We need to have boundary conditions. We need one boundary condition for each derivative. So every time we have a derivative, we need a boundary condition. I'm going to distinguish, there are two types of boundary condition. One is in space, another one in time. I'm going to refer to the boundary conditions as conditions in space. We need six of them. Two in the x direction, two in the y direction, two in the z direction. We need one initial condition for the time derivative. If we don't have those conditions, we can't solve the problem. And that's one of the more important or challenging aspects of groundwater hydrology. Making sure we have enough conditions, making sure they are appropriate conditions, and making sure they're correct conditions. Because if they're not correct, you'll never get a correct answer. It's all part of the modeling process. Now, are there any questions? Is there anything anyone would like me to explain? Because this is the basis, not just of modeling, it's the basis of groundwater hydrology. It's governed by this mathematical equation. So let's look at this equation a little bit more detail, that we can look at variations of this equation, because if we go back and look at this full equation, if kx, ky and kz are variable, then getting an analytical solution to this equation is effectively impossible, unless you know exactly how this varies, which we never do, but unless you do, you'll never get an analytical solution. And by analytical, I mean exact. So if we look at conditions like steady state, in which case hydraulic head does not change with time, if there's no change with time, then sums of flow in must equal flows out. So a change left-hand side is equal to zero. So for steady state conditions, conditions that are not changing with time, then our groundwater flow equation simplifies fairly considerably. If we have a situation or an assumption that we're dealing with homogeneous and asymmetric conditions, then our hydraulic conductivity, K, is a constant. It doesn't vary with space. Now, K doesn't vary with time. Almost never. Because K is a function of the soils. Saturated soils. They do vary over millions of years, but we're not solving this over millions of years. So over the time periods that we're looking at groundwater hydrology, K does not vary. But this then becomes our equation for groundwater flow. And this is a much nicer equation. Because here we're dealing with simple second derivatives. So this is the first derivative of Kx times the first derivative. K is constant. This then reduces to a second derivative, which is just the change of the change of hydraulic head. So I hope you're okay with that. It's just the extension of differential calculus. We still have a time varying component, but it allows us to look at probably much easier solutions. In particular, if we have homogeneous, isotropic, and steady state, we end up with this equation here. And this equation is mathematically beautiful. Because this equation is exactly the same equation that is used to describe many physical phenomena. The movement of heat through a room is controlled by this equation. The movement of electrical conductivity through the brain is this equation. The movement of electrical conductivity through a series of resistors is this equation. And because of that, particularly the heat aspect, there are a very large number of analytical solutions for this equation. So groundwater hydrology, which can reduce to this equation under these conditions, is able to use analytical solutions that people have developed for a whole lot of phenomena which have no connection whatsoever, but are all governed by the same equation. And Laplace's equation is probably the most common equation in physical science. It's also what's used to describe flows at supersonic speeds. So you've got aerodynamics, you've got heat transfer, you've got movement of current, you've got brain activity, and you've got groundwater flow. Are all controlled by this same equation. As I said, the solution of that then is something that allows us to understand groundwater hydrology. Getting solutions from these other sciences allows us then to provide solutions for groundwater hydrology. The one requirement, though, is that all forms need appropriate and sufficient boundary conditions. So if we've got a full three-dimensional problem, we need six boundary conditions. We do not need any initial condition, but we must have boundary conditions in order to get a solution. Any questions? My first question today. I always like the first question. So let's go back to this. So if we're looking at a confined aquifer, we've got water moving in the X direction and the Y direction within the aquifer. And there's also water moving from aquifers above and below. So we need to make sure we know how much water is moving in each of the three directions for a confined aquifer. For an unconfined aquifer, this guy here, we've definitely got water moving in and water moving out. But we assume that any water that comes from above is simply coming from the unsaturated zone. And once it hits here, the only water that's going to be added is through rainfall. We've already considered rainfall and it's just a volumetric. We don't worry about how fast it comes in, it's just a volumetric input. So we include rainfall, if you like, we're simply saying we don't care how fast it comes, it's just in there, and we'll add it in through this term as a mass amount. The movement through it, we don't worry about. The other aspect that we are ignoring is any water that might go from here into a deeper aquifer. And that's a very good point. What we then have to make sure is if there is any leakage from an unconfined aquifer into a confined aquifer, then that leakage is incorporated into this term as well. The whole reason for ignoring flow in the vertical direction is that it simplifies the analysis. It reduces the number of dimensions we're dealing with. Flow in the unconfined aquifer is already messy because of the non-linearity. Including any vertical flow would make it more complex, and we assume that it is taken care of through this extra term arm. So if you like, I mentioned rainfall, recharge, extraction, and pumping, and you can also put, well, R is the rainfall coming in. You can also put leakage from beneath. It would all go into that term there. Any other questions? This is that groundwater flow equation. This is how it is then restricted based on given conditions. The other thing we need is to understand, okay, that's nice theoretically, so what? That's not what we see out in the field. What we see out in the field is the data. We've discussed this already. The only thing we really know about a groundwater system is hydraulic head at a specific location and how it varies with time. We go out and measure the hydraulic head at a specific location, and then we put that together for our understanding of how that varies with time. The other set that we have is the variation of hydraulic head in space. So we have monitoring bores throughout our solution domain. We have them at different aquifers, so there are different colours on this map representing each of the different aquifers. So this one allows us to look at the difference in H with time. This one allows us to look at the difference of H with space. This is the basis of all numerical modeling. We must know a hydraulic head. In order to solve these equations, what we need is hydraulic conductivity to solve for hydraulic head. What we usually have is a limited understanding of hydraulic head and almost no knowledge of hydraulic conductivity. So what we'll see later on tomorrow is, what do we do about that? Mathematically, it's an interesting problem. Physically, it's an impossible problem. You can't solve an equation when the only thing you really know are what you're really trying to find out. That what you need are these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 parameters to solve this equation. And other ones you don't know. So solving the groundwater flow equation is very difficult in real terms. We then have to concentrate on what it is we know. Hydraulic head at specific locations, and hydraulic head and how it varies in the vertical direction with the different colours and in space. The model that we're going to put together is based on this and that. Our understanding of the groundwater system is based on this and that. And this is where we have to start. Any numerical modeling must start with the information we know. Any questions? Thank you for your question. It always helps when I get one, the first one. Okay, I'm way ahead of the game then. And we can have a break. So where